All right, welcome everyone. My name is Gerardo. I'm here at Combat Club with Rodney Brewer. Could you tell me a little bit about your background and what you've done?
Rodney Brewer, I started as a boxer. I started boxing back in like 1993. I'm an old man now.
Yeah, so, yeah. Not that old.
Just when I turned 18.
Here in Florida?
No, in Boston.
Okay.
Then I got sick of the weather and I wanted to move down here because I was just watching South Beach. Oh my God, South Beach, South Beach, South Beach. So I started bartending down in South Beach as soon as I moved down here. And I just, ever since, I've been training in bartending.
Well, did you compete?
Yes, I competed. I competed in professional boxing and MMA.
Okay, all right. So how did you transition into being a coach?
I was a shitty fighter that had no discipline. So I was bartending on South Beach, probably making really good money, and I'd have to go fight for $300. And I was just like, this isn't worth it. I mean, it was cool when you're younger, but as you get older, you're like, I just can't do this. Then I had my daughter in 2000. I'm like, yeah, I just can't do this anymore. So that's when I just was like, I had a couple more MMA fights after that. I wasn't doing the boxing anymore. So I think my last MMA fight was in 2003. And then I just, the money was too good in bartending. So I was just like,
oh, okay.
And then I think, what was it, 2003? Yeah, I started making money cornering people. I was just like, wow, I'm getting money for nothing, for doing stuff I would do for free anyway.
Yeah.
So I just rather corner better people at that point until my skills came. Because I was always good at boxing, always good at jiu-jitsu, but in MMA, like, if you have no wrestling, like, that's a huge hole in your game. And, like, there was all, like, single, like you could be a good boxer and have some MMA wins. But it's not like that anymore. Like, you have to be well-rounded everything. And I had such a dramatic hole in my game in the wrestling aspect where I wasn't comfortable taking any more fights until I fixed that hole.
Right.
And then by that time, I was just like, fuck it. My life was going too good at that point. I'm not going to go fight for $300 or $1,000. It's like...
Makes sense.
Yeah.
So totally that's... makes sense.
And then you start dealing with, like, real world champions. Like, when I started training, like, with Rashad and Anthony Johnson and all those guys, and then you start meeting John Jones, worked with him for his fight against Shogun. So wow. It's just, like... just all worked out.
It's all working out. And now you're at Combat Club.
Oh, yeah.
What programs do you have here?
We have the BJJ program run by Herbert Burns. Great program. Our kickboxing program is run by Angel. He's an ex-pro from American Top Team, and he has the same philosophy as me. He's like, I know way more than I'm ever going to be able to do fighting. Like, the thing with being a fighter is when we were fighting, it was $300. $200, you know, it wasn't anything major, you know, and you just took a lot of abuse. These kids nowadays don't realize how lucky they have it. They're training in everything at such a very young age. We just were like tough boxers or tough kickboxers. We had so many holes in our game, you know, so that's a huge discrepancy that these kids don't have to worry about anymore. They don't have to worry about getting held down and all those dumb situations that we were in, you know.
Yeah.
We just didn't know anything. And the level of training, like when I was an American Top Team, it was good, but there was holes in the training. Like, it was all new. We didn't know how to train. We just thought that you went out there and you sparred as hard as you could, and that's how you got better, which
yeah.
is stupid, you know? But that's majority of the people that I trained with from 2003 to 2010 in American Top Team. That's how they trained.
Yeah. So over here, you train a lot of technique.
It's all drilling, and we'll probably have one hard sparring per week. I mean, it ranges when you get closer to a fight, but one hard big love sparring per week is all you need.
Yeah.
You don't need to be getting your brain beat up all the time. You know, you need a rest.
Yeah, that's true, that's true.
You can retain so much more when you're going at a slower pace rather than that fast, chaotic pace where you're not learning range, distance, and you're kind of learning under pressure. You don't learn well under pressure. You have to have a relaxed mind in order to learn. So the drilling, yeah, you have to drill longer than, say if we went in sparring, we would probably do like 8 to 10 rounds hard. Your brain really can't absorb anything like that. If you do 2 hours of just like drilling, you retain so much more.
Yeah,
it's such a better way to learn. And it took me a while because I came from a background where you just beat the shit out of each other all the time. Like, oh, that's how you be tough. No. You know, you start getting brain damage and then you're like, fuck, this is not the way to do it. You know, and you realize that as you get older, but when you're young, you're invincible. Nothing can hurt you. You're a fucking demon. You can go 100 miles an hour into a brick wall and be fine. When you get older.
Then you turn 30.
Exactly. Then you start learning all this shit. Like, man, I could hit all these angles if I just relax my shoulders more, if I just relax my footwork. You know, everything just starts feeding together. You know, it's the amount of time that you do it not under duress. The amount of time that you do training where it's just nice and light, you learn so much more. You're like, holy shit, this is so easy. I put so much pressure on myself doing this the whole time, trying to go forward, when I could just... Because when you're younger, you want to rush the action. Mm. You want to press the action. You always want to fucking just go out there and be an animal. When you get older, you learn you can't do that. You know?
Right, right.
So that's the beauty of the sport, man. Like, I've trained with the best in the world, and like, you still, there's so much I don't even know. Like, there's so much you learn. Like, when you're younger, you think you know everything. Like, oh, I'm just gonna knock the guy out. Well, how are you gonna do that? I'm just gonna fucking punch him in the face. Well, that's the stupidest answer I've ever heard in my life. As you get older, you have setups and you have a certain philosophy on how to get there.
Right.
You know, like when I was younger, I would just throw punches for no reason. There was no rhyme or reason. I just wanted to punch you in the face. Now everything, like how I teach my guys, everything's a setup and everything has a purpose. You don't throw something unless you have a purpose to do it, you know?
Well, that's awesome that you're able to share your experience with these guys, especially the young guys.
And that's the best part about coaching. Like, I was a shitty fighter because of my poor choices outside the cage. You know, I was always a good fighter. I made shitty choices. I wouldn't train. Like, just life was too easy for me at that point. You know, I just, the women, everything, I was just chasing everything. Right. It was negative. The whole thing was negative. And when you change your brain and your thought process, everything's different. Everything's like, wow, I didn't know this was possible.
Well, yeah, that comes with time, yeah, and wisdom.
It takes a while, and everyone matures at different levels. Like, there's good guys out there that are great fighters, but it just takes them that one or two extra years to drill to become perfect. You know, there's always a hole in someone's game, but once you drill it enough, that hole's gone. You know, people want to put so much thought on the knocking out aspect or the submission aspect instead of the process and how to get there. You know, they want to say, oh, I'm just going to go fucking submit, I'm going to go do this, and they'll train with all wasted energy. Instead of, like, as you get older, you learn how to conserve energy, you learn how to fucking slowly but surely wind down the clock. It's like any sport, it's control. If you can control it the most, 90% of the time, you're going to win. You know, if you can control the pace, the range, the distance, 90% of the time, you're going to win.
Right, right.
You know, and it's hard telling these kids that when they have brains where they just want to kill. They're nuts.
Yeah.
You know, and I like it, but it's not long term. You know, you just learn so much more as you get older.
Absolutely, absolutely. Hey, I appreciate you sharing.
Sorry to ramble on like that.
No, it's all good.
Like,
you know, it's all good.
That's the love I have for the sport, man. It's just, I love coaching. Yeah. I love being in the position I'm at now.
Do you find it more rewarding now as a coach than as when you were
way
a
more? Because when I knocked people out when I was fighting, it was just like, you know, my ego. It was a false person that I was back then.
Yeah.
My ego fed everything.
I hear you.
You know what I'm saying? So it wasn't even real. Even when I did it, it was like, yeah, I'm a badass. It wasn't real. You know, I mean, the knockout was real and the win the fight was real, but I don't know. It's weird to explain. Like, I just didn't appreciate it the way I should have.
Right.
You know, because it came too easy. And then when I got into MMA, it was totally different. It was like, fuck, I gotta worry about this wrestling thing, I gotta worry about this, I gotta worry about head kicks. I can't tell you how many times I get head kicks. I tried to shoulder roll out of it like boxing. It was so fucking stupid.
Yeah. Well, you learn from it, man. Hopefully these guys are learning from it.
Yeah, man. I just like it because they're learning from someone that's actually gone through it all, and not just a wrestler, not just a boxer, not just one aspect of the sport. All our coaches here have done everything. So that's where the knowledge comes from. Is if you're a specialist, you can get someone good with their hands, but you can't equate that to how to set it up to avoid a takedown. You can't equate that to anything else, you know, unless you've done it. And they're like, okay, well, then just make it that little adjustment. And that's the beauty that we have here. They're all MMA fighters, you know, so they can make those adjustments.
Right.
You know, which is, it's huge.
That's awesome. That's awesome, man. Well, I'd like to talk about some of the fighters that I photographed in the past. You know, first off, Jornel Lugo, yo, he's one of the first guys that even introduced me to the sport. And allowed, you know, he gave me the opportunity to photograph him, and so, you know, I'm always going to be a fan of Jornel, and he's really good. He has a fight coming up in Bellator, I believe, in like 2 weeks, right?
Yep, we're going. His fight IQ, that's the thing about Jornel. Like, I might have been a better athlete at his age, at 23. His fight IQ is so far superior to anyone that we have in here. It's amazing. To the point where the people who he drills with become that much better.
Yeah.
Because his fight IQ is so good. And by fight IQ, he just makes the right choices on everything he does. Whether it's striking, kicking, takedown, feints, like everything just flows perfect with that kid.
Another guy is Brandon Carroll. I know he's just starting off.
Jersey.
You know, he served in the Marine Corps, so we have that bond. You know what I mean? But I see that he's working hard and he's coming up in the amateur ranks.
Jersey was always good. He's gotten really good in the past 6 months. Like, yeah. Really good. And that's the problem. That's the problem we're having now. And now the word's getting out, and it's hard for us to find fights for him.
Yeah.
So that's another thing. I need to showcase his talent, and like, no one's taking fights. And it's coming to the end of the year, he's gonna fight. So yeah.
Well, I hope he gets a fight here pretty soon.
He will. It might not be against the opponent we want, but it's gonna be against the opponent. So yeah. He just build his record until someone real wants to fight him, and this is how it is. So hopefully we can get on this XFN card, Daniel K, with someone good.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And another guy I photographed was Shawn Brown.
Shawn Brown.
And he's a monster.
That's my son.
Is that my son? Right?
Yep.
And his kid.
That's family right there.
His child too, right?
Yep. He comes in every day. I can't tell you the amount of times I've just been holding Stetson when he's training. Like, it's just like a family environment here, man. Like, that's why I like it so much, because it's everything that my boxing wasn't. No, boxing is a very ego-oriented sport. You know, it's not like a real family atmosphere. MMA, even American Top Team, 2003 to 2010, it was a family atmosphere. I'm still friends with all those guys. Mike Brown, Thiago Alves, we're just friends.
You guys are so close, and I have a photo that I want to give you over here. And this is actually one of my favorite photos that I took. This one right over here.
Yep.
Man, you guys are close together no matter what. You know, this is a moment of prayer before the fight for David Troach. Back in November, so I want to give this to you, man.
This is the perfect poster of just no egos involved, just four guys just praying. That's all it really is. It's just, that's how we are here, man. It's just, fighters want to draw from the other power fighters before they go out. That's what they want to do.
Yep.
And that's all we're doing right there. We're just saying a nice prayer and just saying, stay safe, have a great showing, and go home safe to your family. That's all you're saying.
You know, even though it's such a small moment of you guys taking the time to pray with each other, that comes from a place of love.
So it's sharing energy. We beautiful. All just sit there, and we just want, you want to feel another warrior's energy. You just want to be like, okay, everything's good. We're going to war now. Let's go.
Yeah.
And absolutely. That's just what it is.
Absolutely.
I mean, the simplest form. It's just love right there, man.
No doubt. You know, I served in the military, and I've gone overseas to war, so I know that camaraderie, and that's what... That's really one reason why I got...
It's what gets you through. It's what gets you through the hard times, man.
No doubt. No brotherhood and camaraderie, not even that, but I know you have women fighters here too.
Yep.
And everyone here is a family, and I certainly appreciate that.
And everyone looks out for everyone else.
Tell people how they could contact you about classes or anything.
We're online, just Combat Club. Mm-hmm. And just our class schedule's online too. Just come in, try out free class, see if it's for you. I mean... We are a much smaller gym than the American Top Teams and everyone else, but it's an all-family gym. Like, our kids class alone has like 44 kids, and we have two back-to-back. So there's over 80 kids in our kids program. Our kickboxing class is always packed. That's always at 6:30. Our MMA program, like, it's just, we have everything that you want. Everything you want to train, just come in, try it. Try it for a week, see if you like it. If it's not for you, cool.
Is there a phone number?
There's a phone number. It's on the website.
Well, Rodney, I really appreciate you taking the time for this, brother. And I hope you have a good day, man.
Thank you so much.